house on fire?
I feel like that house might be.
Oh my gosh.
Oh my gosh.
Let's get out of this on fire.
It just blew up. It ravaged through this landscape, cut across the ridge, came down into this canyon, picked up winds, and flew up canyon all in a matter of hours, and all at high severity, high heat, high intensity, that it left what you see behind here today.
What Louise is describing is the 2014 King Fire. At the time, it was one of the most devastating ecological events in California's history, but one that's been dwarfed in the 8 years since. My name is Shane. I'm a journalist, filmmaker, and I'm one of the people behind the camera here at Ecosia. And today we're going to be talking about why are wildfires in places like California increasing in their size and intensity? And what can we do about it? But first, I think it's good to get some context. Of the 20 largest fires in California's entire recorded history, 12 of them were in just the last 5 years. To get why this is happening, it's important to understand what California's forest ecology should look like.
These trees grew up and evolved with fire as part of their natural history. They even kindle it. They drop their dry needles on the ground, almost creating like a nice flammable mat for a low severity wildfire to just burn the ground and clear it and maybe take out some of the smaller trees so the forests don't get too dense.
What Luis just said there is very important for our story. These ancient fires were, for the most part, very small, and they just crawled along the ground and cleaned up the forest and were very vital to its health. Indigenous people understood their importance, and they even set them intentionally in a practice sometimes called cultural burning. So when colonists poured into California almost 200 years ago, they found a very different forest than the one that we see today.
I remember talking to a forester, an old timer, who would tell me these stories, how they would be able to get up on horseback and just slowly go through the forest to be able to monitor. You can't do that. You can barely, you know, suck your tummy in and try to get through all the brush that's there.
The forests that Britt is describing were created by colonialization. Since then, they've been used for resource extraction and recreation, and because of that, state and federal governments have done everything that they can to keep them from burning at all.
More and more families are moving closer and closer to our forests. That's why, if you're careless with fire when you go to the forest, you could burn a lot more than trees.
For a few generations, this no-fire approach seemed to be working. There were fewer fires. But by preventing and suppressing wildfires, the landscape filled up with dense, highly flammable forests, which has led directly to the huge fires that we see today.
Of a million acres, here's the latest on the three largest fires, starting with the Camp Fire in Butte County. It has already become the most destructive and deadliest wildfire in California history. It's burned over 140,000 acres.
When you remove wildfire from the equation that these ecosystems have evolved with, then in these dense forested landscapes, you have what's ready to, what's now a tinderbox essentially for a hot, high severity wildfire to burn through.
In 2021, an area roughly the size of Belgium burned in the American West. According to FEMA, the U.S. agency tasked with handling these kinds of disasters, some 50 million people live in about 700,000 communities at risk of wildland fire. So in the face of this, so-called let-it-burn policies have proven deeply unpopular.
Our federal system, our state system, they're geared towards fighting fires in a militaristic airplanes and helicopters and hand crews and trying to extinguish a fire once it started. And I really think that with the right investment and the right incentives, we can flip that on its head, create healthy forests that are resilient to the catastrophic wildfires that we're currently trying to put out after they've started.
The approach Evan is criticizing here is not just ineffective, it's also extremely expensive. In the last fire season alone, the state of California gave out an estimated $3 billion just for its daily operations, and another $1.3 billion for its emergency spending, which is up from about $100 million just a decade ago. And this ballooning budget reflects the fires themselves. Every year, they're bigger than ever.
We have two new terms, megafire, for fires over 100,000 acres, which we're seeing regularly, and we saw plenty of last year. This King fire was 97,000 acres, so it wouldn't even be classified as a megafire. And we came up with a new term last year in 2020 called a gigafire, a fire that reaches over 1 million acres in size.
It's not just the size of these new fires that's so worrying. It's actually how hot they are. Most native species and systems didn't evolve to survive fires of this intensity. So their higher temperatures kill the organisms in the soil, destroy the native seed banks, and wipe out the older trees. The only survivors are a few fast-growing species of brush.
Brush fields just don't necessarily provide the same biodiversity, habitat, water benefits, but also they light back up and more frequently. So if you have fire after fire after fire, then you have these moonscapes that there is no seed bank, and then we have our erosion issues and our flooding issues, and it's all connected, right? Drought, flood, fire, it's all connected. And exacerbated, right, with climate change. It's just this negative feedback loop.
Some forests were born to burn. So to restore them, we first need to protect them from bad fire and then carefully reintroduce good fire back onto the landscape. I actually get to meet two partners who are striving to do just that on the ground in California. With 40% of California's forests being on private land, so-called fuel reduction projects like this one from the American Forest Foundation work to thin private forests and lay the groundwork for the good fires of the future. With so many forests going up in smoke, it's also important to restore already burned forests in ways that bring them back into a healthy fire cycle. So on public lands, American Forest is taking this on with their own special method.
I always say that not all trees are good and not all fire is bad. So capital letter R reforestation really moves past just planting the sexy seedling and invites the conversation to talk about what actually has to happen before and after to get big healthy trees, which is what we were planting for in the first place.
This exciting technique starts immediately after the fire blows through. First, the standing but dead trees are cut down. That fast-growing pesky brush is removed. And then the native saplings are planted, and it's all monitored and maintained.
There is no silver bullet solution, right? And we know that things aren't stagnant. And we know that we need flexibility to try new things and to increase the pace and scale in which the things that we do know work well can get done.
And the deer are walking back. Yeah.
Access to groups like American Forest Foundation, there could be more of those type of groups who are doing the outreach. The education and the outreach and then the funding, they have to work together to do the projects that I see as being kind of the most important.
In places like California, these fires might be worse than ever. But we are also more able than ever to bring healthy cycles back to our landscapes.
Humans have changed their environment. That's what we've done for hundreds of thousands of years. That's one of our defining characteristics, whether it's through agriculture or forestry or now fisheries in the ocean, we are changing our environment. And if we do it thoughtfully and intentionally with an eye towards the future and keeping our earth as a nice place to live for not only ourselves, but for other species as well, it's doable. It's kind of expensive is the truth though. And it's a lot of work.
We have to have conversations with creative private partners that are willing to come to the table. And Ecosia is modeling that for us.
In the end, it all comes down to how we see our forests. As a natural resource to extract from, or as a shared ecological space that we choose to give back to.
Let's retain the largest trees in a forest. Let's try to protect important watersheds in a way that makes sense for habitat or whether it's just downstream water users. Let's do that in a way that makes sense. And then let's support the rural businesses and the rural economies that kind of would help all of this compound on itself.
I would like to see a forest here again, but I would like to see a slightly different forest, one that is more resilient to wildfire, as there will be another wildfire that comes through the area. It's no longer a matter of if, it's a matter of when.
I'm actually more hopeful today than I have been in a really long time. And, you know, yes, the largest single wildfire in California history blew through my backyard, my neighborhood last year. And I can say I am more hopeful today than I have been, because we do have solutions and there are things we can do right now to scale up. We just have to have the social will to do it, and we all have to be in the same sandbox.
As long as there exists the combustible combination of wind, dry fuel, and people, there will always be the danger of wildfires in California.
Thanks for watching. If you're new here, this is the Ecosia channel. Like, share, comment, and subscribe, and have a great day.